Land at Shaw Bishop, Bishop Instruments of Bose, talking today about Naples violin makers from the late 19th century. Here we are in London. It's a bit cloudy, a bit cold, or as I like to call it, a perfect British summer's day. It's a bit dark in here, so I'll try and show you my pictures if I can closely so you can see what I'm talking about, the instruments. Right, so today we're talking about the late Naples makers. So if you think of Naples, southern Italy has always had financial problems. Anyone who's been to Naples will know that. The famous Galliano family all come from Naples. Alessandro Galliano was the big father of the family, regarded as probably the finest maker of the family. Then we move on into Niccolo Galliano, Joseph Galliano, the brothers Raphael and Antonio. So they spanned 150 years of the Galliano family. So, and all making violins in a very similar style, and anyone that's seen their violins would know that you could say the workmanship is not as fine as Cremona. So we had in Cremona, of course, we had Stradivari, so as the king of the workmanship, but Naples is sort of quite the opposite, so a bit more free, easygoing, I guess home of pizza, whatever, you know. Now, the Galliano family went on for a very long time, were the big masters of Naples from at least 1750 or 1740 to 1850. Everyone that was around that period made violins in a very similar style. So slightly rough, purfling. This is not a Galliano. I should get a Galliano, but I'll leave it for the moment. So anyway, when the final Galliano family members, Raphael and Antonio, stopped making, I believe they were the last ones to do that, and died. It was a new wave of violin makers, but still making very much in the Galliano tradition. So you get makers like Alfonso della Corta, who was born in 1836, and he died relatively young in 1884. His instruments are still inspired by the school of Galliano. So here's a violin here we have. I'm just seeing that. See that one there, and this is very much in the style of a Galliano or a brothers Galliano or even Ventapane. So people might know the Ventapane family, and so it's not really his own model. This one's quite high arching, so slightly tubby. And I have another one here I can show you as well, which is quite the opposite, a little bit more basic in appearance. So whereas the first one I showed you has is nice coloured varnish. You see that? Nice colours. This one is a bit more plain, a bit more simple, should we say. Scroll on this one, I'll hold it up to the camera. See there, it's all very tight scroll, and it comes out the front here a bit front heavy, which is typical Galliano. So that's a Galliano style scroll. Maybe even Ventapane, probably a bit more in style. Whereas this one is definitely, this same maker as I said, Della Corta, is a bit on his own style, okay? So, different style of violins. We move along to someone from the same period, Vincenzo Postiglione. Now, his work is a bit more varied to Della Corta. Postiglione studied with Vincenzo Iorio, so a little bit older, and his work is very prolific in the sense that he was around from 1835 to 1916, so it goes right into the early 20th century. This is a violin of his here, made in 1896, I think, something like that. Inside, he does a lot of writing and stuff inside his violins often. He had a lot of helpers and a lot of people that studied with him, particularly Giovanni Pestucci, studied with Postiglione. I'm going to get onto that in a minute. This violin, the Postiglione, is not so much of a Galliano copy, but we certainly know it's a Naples style. The purfling is very light, light-coloured purfling, slightly rushed, but it's very much, I don't want to say the words rough and ready, because it's not nice. But Postiglione violins always sound very nice, and they're always very interesting. His student, so he had Giovanni Pestucci, Alfredo Contino, which are very nice violins. Often these guys were seemingly copying each other. So we've all come across lots of Pastuccis that are all labelled Galliano, members of the family. We've come across Postiglioni's the same way, Della Quarta, exactly the same. So it seemed to be that if you lived in Naples, you made a violin with a Galliano label. That was sort of standard practice. And it continued well into the mid-20th century with the Bella Rosa, Sanino, one of the great makers, Sanino, prolific maker in Naples, up until about, I think, 1915, 1920, when he moved to Rome. But he still labelled his violins Naples, and some of his Galliano copies are incredibly convincing. And I can say the same with Pastucci. So let's move on to Pastucci. Now, I've got two violins here by Pastucci. I've actually got three that I own, but this both of these are labelled Galliano. So if we look here, that's quite a convincing copy. This one is labelled, let me tell you, Gennaro Galliano. It's definitely not going to fool anyone for that. But you're going towards Brothers Galliano, and here's another one with a very red varnish. I'll just show you that. And this is labelled, yes, Raphael and Antonio Galliano, with a nice label inside. Okay. Now, I've seen a number of violins masquerading as Galliano that are Pastucci. So when people bring in Raphael and Antonio Galliano, first thing I'm looking at, okay, we've got a Pastucci on our hands. Recently I saw a viola that had been regarded for a long time as Brothers Galliano, but was in fact Pastucci. And for me, I love these Naples instruments because they're just something a little bit different. You think of the if you look at the schools of making in Italy at that time, we had Bologna, where we have the Fiorini family and people influenced by Raphael Fiorini, Giuseppe Fiorini, and then of course Poggi. So perfection, particularly Raphael, Giuseppe, and Poggi, very very perfection in terms of the making. Whereas the Naples is like they just go with the flow, which I quite like. Although I do like a Poggi, don't get me wrong. So how about I have a quick play, and you can all laugh at my humble violin playing as an ex-violist of not playing for 15 years. Right, so here we have a Della Quarta, 1860, 1870 of Naples. Now, that is my standard piece I seem to play on everything. I'll play it on the next one. So again, another Della Quarta. This is labeled 18, it's an original label, which is quite rare, 1850 something. Probably a little bit later, I think. A little bit more full sound to me, that one. I quite like that. We move on to Postiglioni. I'm going to practice, I promise. I keep saying I'm going to do some more. Some scales, perhaps. Right, so Postiglioni, 1896. Okay, and then we move on to the Pastuccis. Graham Park saying, I won't laugh. I'm sorry. And then the last Pastucci, another Brothers Galliano copy. There we have it. So that's the Naples school of that period. I did leave out, I'm not sure I mentioned Vincenzo Sannino. I do have one of those, but not with me. Oh, what is the bow? That's just a new bow by Pascal Camura from Montpellier. He's one of those crazily talented people that makes violins and makes bows as well. Very nice. Before I finish my ramble, yes, Vincenzo Sannino, one of the most prolific of the 20th century makers, and one of my particular favourite makers. His copies are out of this world. Guadagnini copies we've seen, of course, all the Naples copies he does as well. But anyway, thank you very much. I will speak to you next week. Maybe next week we'll talk about the Voller brothers of London of the same period, so the late 19th century, sort of 1880s, 1900, 1910. They were brothers living in London and they made the most fantastic copies. So anyway, thank you very much. Have a good weekend and I'll see you next week.